Welcome to Lunch and Learn. I'm Cynthia Martin.
And I'm Patsy Shreve, and we're going to be your hosts today. Today's topic is forgiveness.
Yeah, and today we're going to be talking about forgiveness, and we believe that forgiveness is the most important topic of all topics in Christianity because it all begins with forgiveness. We obtained forgiveness from the Lord, and the Lord puts so much importance on the actual forgiveness. It's essential for us, for our freedom and our wholeness. When you carry unforgiveness in your heart, it's like drinking poison and expecting the other person to die. It only hurts you, not them. And even though we kind of know that, we've heard that over and over again, somehow we forget that process when it comes to an issue where we've been hurt or where we've been offended. I was thinking the other day of the scripture that talks about agree with your adversary quickly. And that is not a real popular scripture. It's not even a real popular thing to do. But you know, that was the heart of who David was. And that is really the heart of people who are humble and really want all that God has for them. It's to turn and to give it all back to the Lord and say, Lord, what do you have to say about this? So there's a level of freedom that comes in our lives only when we forgive. And we'll never reach that level until we become a forgiving person. Right. Patsy?
Yeah, so point one today, we're going to talk about what forgiveness is not. Because we think, oh yeah, I know, it's this and it's this and it's this. Well, first of all, it's not a feeling. It is an absolute choice. You have to choose to forgive. You're not going to feel like forgiving all the time. You're not going to want to forgive because they've hurt you and those feelings are still there. But it is a choice, a command that you're going to choose to make. And it's not saying that what the person did was okay for what, if they hurt you and abused you or whatever they did to you. It's not just because you forgive them. It doesn't mean that you're saying, yeah, it was fine that they hurt me or they abused me or they did this to me or they did that to me. That's not what forgiveness is. Like Cynthia said, it's for you. Forgiveness is for you. It's not for them. And it isn't healing, but it can open the door for healing. So when you choose to forgive, then that healing, now the Lord can come in and heal those places where you've held unforgiveness and anger and bitterness and resentment towards that person. He can come in and heal your heart. And it is not negotiable. It is a command from God. He requires it. So we can't say, oh, well, if they forgive or if they say they're sorry right. or if they do this, then I will forgive. No, that's not the way it works.
That's right.
Cynthia? Yeah.
And when we forgive, when we refuse to forgive, we're setting ourselves up to be the judge because we're saying that I know more than you, God, and that we see the bigger picture and we don't. And it's really sad. And we're not negating people's pain. We're really right. not. Mm-hmm. We're not. And I think it's important that we separate. And I think we'll talk a little bit about this further into what we're talking about is we separate forgiveness from healing as well. We have to forgive, but then we get healing separately. So what is forgiveness then? We've told you about what it's not. Definitions of forgiveness are to grant relief for payment or from payment. So I've always said, you know, if you hold them on forgiveness and they've really done something horrible to you, how could they pay you back? I'm sorry, just doesn't always get it. And, you know, some people are waiting for that someone to reply back that they did wrong. And even if they did, would that really pay you back for the hurt and the pain that you're carrying? So really, forgiveness is to grant a person relief from payment. You're saying, okay, God, I'm going to release this debt. I'm going to give it to you. Because when we release ourselves from being the debt collector and we give that over to God, then God will deal with them. But if we're going to deal with them, God says, oh, I'm not going to do anything because you've set yourself up as judge. And so when we give that debt to God, then God can do what he needs to do with that debt. So it's to give the person a pardon. Again, it's not, you know, in our society, when someone gives a pardon, that means they don't ever have to pay a penalty. A penalty is really assessed by God, and that's between them and God alone, not between you. There's no one worth getting between yourself and having a relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ, for sure. So it's to excuse the offense without a penalty or without that payment, to cease to feel resentment against. That's a little harder. Mm-hmm. It is possible, but it is a little harder. We're going to talk about that as well today. It's to cancel the debt. It's to say, I'm not collecting anymore. You know, if they was to come back and say, okay, how am I going to take care of this debt? It's like, nope, I gave that over to God. It's no longer mine. And that's really, truly what that is. It's to choose not to hurt those who have hurt you. Because, you know, we say so many times that hurt people hurt people. And when we're in unforgiveness, sometimes that leads to resentment. That goes to revenge. Boy, tell me, I can tell you about, I used to be the queen of revenge. So unforgiveness is really letting go and just saying, you know what? I'm not going to allow this to come between me and my God. I'm going to give that over to God. Let him take care of it, because there's not anything that I can do about it anyway. And I'm going to release the payment and let God be the collector.
That's right. And it is a command. Like mm-hmm. I said before, it's a command from God. It's not an option. You're releasing that person to God so that God can deal with them. You're not the judge anymore. God becomes the judge in his rightful position, because that's his rightful position. And the scripture says, for if you forgive men their trespasses, your heavenly Father will also forgive you. But if you do not forgive their trespasses, neither will your Father forgive your trespasses. That's a pretty serious verse to consider and to think about. That's in Matthew 6, 14 to 15.
And you know, Patsy, that reminds me of the story that I tell a lot about the big snowplow. And we live in Florida now, but originally both of us are from snow states. So we understand this illustration. If you're from the north, you'd understand this illustration as well. If you're from the south, let me explain it to you. In the wintertime, we have roads that run we have trucks that run the roads, and they plow the roads. And the big trucks, when we get a big snowfall, where I came from, it was not unusual to get a 12-inch snowfall in an evening. And so these trucks would run up and down the freeway or the expressway, whatever you want to call it. And they had these big V plows, you know, just like that. And they'd be on the front of the truck, and they'd just be huge. And they'd go out like this. And those trucks would run down the road 50, 60 mile an hour. And they just, these big V trucks, they would just be throwing snow, probably 30, 40 feet. I mean, I don't know. I'm not really great about length, but it was a long ways, way off the road. But they were just huge. These big V snow plows were probably, I don't know, at least 6 feet tall. They're just huge. One day I'll get a picture of myself standing next to one, and they go down through the road. And you know, the Father gave me a picture of that because I was such a person that needed so much forgiveness. And he showed me, you know, you have a little shovel, the little round ones that you would dig out like a post hole, or you would dig a hole with, not even a big snow shovel. And he said, you're issuing out forgiveness the size of this shovel. And then he showed me the picture of the V plow, and this is the forgiveness that you need. And I was immediately, you know, when the Lord shows you something, you're immediately thankful, but you're also repentive, because repentance can be so good. And I remember crying out saying, oh God. And you know, when we get at that picture, when we realize that the measure that we give out forgiveness is the measure that we're going to give back. That was just the scripture, Patsy, that you were just reading. Mm-hmm. That if we refuse to forgive others, then he's going to refuse to forgive us. And so that has always made forgiveness so real to me. When I look inside myself and I look at how much forgiveness I need, it's so much easier to forgive other people with that concept. So why is forgiveness necessary? It's the principal key to pave the way in all other areas of freedom. It breaks the negative spiritual chain, the bond between people, releasing both sides into freedom. You know, Patsy and I also know a story. When I was an intern at Brownsville Revival School of Ministry, right within the first couple of weeks when I began my first internship, one of my mentors who really pushed me, and that's the kind of mentor you want in your life, somebody who believes more in your gifts than you believe in them. And I was in a session with her, and a woman came in, and she led this young girl through forgiveness of her mother. Her mother they'd had a terrible rift, and the young girl did not want to. I mean, she was you know, medium young. She was married, just married, but she didn't want to forgive her mother. But my mentor, she talked to her about it, and we explained the purpose of forgiveness, and exactly what her mother had done was not right. But it's not about whether they did was right or not, as we've accepted. So she finally, okay, she agreed to forgive her mother. And just as we'll go on through our teaching, and we asked her to write a letter. Now, this letter she didn't mail to her mother, but we had her right there in that session write out that letter and choose to forgive her mother. And she went home, and she came back the next week for her second appointment. And she was so excited, because when she went home just a day or two later, she received a letter in the mail from her mother. And her mother openly asked for her forgiveness and told her how much she loved her and asked that they could reconcile their relationship. You know, there's no way that mother knew that she had forgiven her and broke that blockade in that relationship. We have story after story after story of things that happen when you choose to forgive. Patsy?
Amen. And of course, the consequences for not forgiving are very severe.
Yeah.
And
yeah.
I mean, the Bible tells us that the walls that you think that you're building, you think you're building a fortress and to protect yourself from getting hurt again. And so I'm not going to let them hurt me again. I'm going to build this wall around me, and I'm just not going to let that happen. I'm not going to forgive them because they don't deserve my forgiveness. I know, I can get my head going too. I'll get them and whatever. What you're actually building is a prison, and it's only going to keep you trapped and in further bondage. So when you do release that forgiveness, you get free from that prison that you have built that you thought was possibly a fortress, but it becomes a prison. And in the Bible, it says in Mark 11, 25 and 26, forgive if you have aught against anyone, else God won't forgive you. Mm-hmm. Oh my goodness, that is pretty severe to me. Mm-hmm. That God won't forgive me if I don't choose to forgive somebody else.
Right.
And in Matthew 18:35, you will be turned over to the tormentors if you don't forgive from your heart. So some of you wonder, why am I being tormented all the time? Why am I having all these problems? Why is this always constantly happening? Why does the enemy have access? Well, one thing you can do is ask God, is there someone I need to forgive?
Yeah.
Because perhaps that's why the enemy has access. And then in 1 John 1:9, it says, when you forgive, then you receive God's forgiveness and cleansing.
Right.
And it's like, wow, to me, you know, that's amazing, because to receive his forgiveness and to receive that cleansing, I have to choose to forgive.
Yeah.
And you may not feel like choosing, but you have to make that choice.
Right.
So
right.
Who do you need to forgive? Mm-hmm. Well, there's others, and there's God, and there's yourself.
Yeah.
Those are the three areas of forgiveness that you need to consider. And when you're considering that, then I have an example of a cross here. And this cross, we have the different sections of the cross here. And for the first section here, so we look at this up and down, and I said you need God's forgiveness. So we need God's forgiveness, of course, we know that. But also, you may say, I need to forgive God, or I need to release God from what I'm holding him accountable for, because I didn't understand that situation. So I have unforgiveness and bitterness in my heart towards God.
Exactly. And Patsy, sorry to interrupt, but
that's,
you know, I think people don't understand. I mean, that might freak you out a little bit. It might get your little religion, if you're got a religious button, it might push on it a little bit, or might shake you, and you're like, how can I, what would I forgive God for? He's perfect. Mm-hmm. But our emotions aren't logical. And so really what we're dealing with is our anger, disappointment towards God.
Right. Mm-hmm.
But yeah, I think that we totally miss that so often when people to people about forgiveness. They really need to look at places in which they believe that God has failed them or disappointed them,
right,
and really get it out with God.
That's right. And he's big enough to handle it. He already knows that you have that anger towards him. So you're not, and we all know in our mind, we can say, well, you know, he doesn't need our forgiveness, or I don't need to forgive him.
Right.
But when you're holding that bitterness and anger in your heart, yes, you need to choose to say, Lord, I forgive you, because I didn't understand that situation, or I didn't understand what was going on. So this vertical bar, I might have said horizontal before, this vertical bar represents between you and God. And so this is the forgiveness that takes place not only from God, but to God. And then we have this horizontal bar here that represents you and others. And so we need to choose to forgive others, because others have hurt you. And they're forgiving us also. So that goes back and forth that way. So we have to make that choice to forgive other people that have hurt us, that have disappointed us, that have said things, whether they knew it or not, but has caused pain or anger. Maybe it could be deep, it could be light, it doesn't matter. But we need to make those choices to forgive those people. Then we have this circle part right here, and you're going, I wonder what that circle is. Well, that circle represents yourself. And it's so, so, so important to forgive yourself. And I know in my own life, I could do this and I could do this, but this was more difficult because I held myself to a really high standard. And so forgiving myself was a lot more difficult. And I'd say, but I did this, I did that. And I'd beat myself up over it all the time. Well, I finally came to the conclusion that I'm not bigger than God. And if God can forgive me, then I need to be able to forgive myself. Because I am not God. And if he can forgive me, then I can choose to forgive myself also.
Exactly. And you know, Patsy, that's a great explanation and a great graphic to explain it. And there are also some levels of forgiveness, you know, because people say, well, I forgave them, but I don't want to have lunch with them. Well, I understand that too. There's a difference between forgiveness and trusting a person again. Mm-hmm. You know, some people, you're not ever going to be best friends with again. And right. that some of that's wisdom. But there are levels of forgiveness, because our first level, the one that God requires, is that we forgive them. And we request, when we're working with someone, is that you do that verbally, because our words have so much power. Mm-hmm. And when we forgive by faith, it's a choice. We see, we make a forgiveness choice to choose. And I've always said that forgiveness is like a train. And I use this illustration all the time. I wish trains still had cabooses, because when I started this, they used to have cabooses. But if you can imagine a train, it has an engine and they used to have a caboose. And our forgiveness choice is like the engine, and our feelings are the caboose. And so I'm here to tell you, Patsy's here to tell you, that when we make choices, our feelings in regards to forgiveness and many other things in some of the sessions that we deal with, when we make a choice, our feeling will follow, because it follows our choice. Consequently, when we make bad choices, our feelings follow those choices as well. But in this particular instance, we're talking about the levels of forgiveness. And our first level is what God requires, is that we choose to forgive. He doesn't require us to do something that we can't do. We can make a choice to forgive. And the choice is like the train, the engine on the train. The feeling will follow with the caboose. Now, how many of you, we lived in Colorado, Patsy and her husband and my husband and I, we all lived in Colorado for a few years together. And I'm telling you, out west, they got some seriously long trains. They're going from I don't know where, and they're heading down into, I believe, into New Mexico. And I would just watch those things. You know, we have some in Pensacola where we live, but they're real short, and other places you see them and they may have 3 or 4 cars, but those trains out there in Colorado would be long. I mean, I don't have no idea how many cars, but I would think maybe at least almost a mile long, and I'm not exaggerating. They were huge, but the end did follow the beginning. Mm-hmm. So it doesn't matter how long the train is, your feeling will follow your choice. Feelings always follow choices. Right. Pats, you want to tell us about the other levels?
Yeah. And so the second level would be the emotional. Mm-hmm. Just when those feelings have followed that train, and it could take longer depending on the length of your train. If it's really a deep hurt, if it's been a deep or hurtful offense, or it could abuse. Be your attitude or abuse when it's very severe hurt and wounding, or anger, there's a lot of anger involved with it, then that train could have a lot more cars on it.
That's right.
So it might take a lot longer for that caboose, for those feelings to follow that choice. And once you've made that choice, then you can make another choice to pray that that person or situation will help you move into that third level.
You know, it's not always good to pray for somebody because we're always doing it with the God bless them sometimes.
I know.
But haven't you found that, Patsy? That
no,
moves
absolutely.
Us into that next level.
That's right.
And when we make the choice, you know, I just need to pray for this person because I know I need it for me.
Right.
And then it moves us into the next level. I think that's so true.
That's true. And then the third level is a biblical or your heart forgiveness, which is the true forgiveness. When you can look at that situation and you don't feel pain, you don't feel anger, those emotions just aren't there on the surface. You've released all those judgments and accusations towards the person that hurt you, and you no longer feel that pain when you think of that situation. It doesn't immediately grip you. That's one of my indicators, is if I've truly forgiven from the heart and gotten to that third level, is when I mention their name or the situation, I don't feel that inside anymore and that want to be angry or upset again. Remember, the past can't be changed.
That's right.
Can only be forgiven.
That's right. That's excellent, Patsy. So, you know, I used to go, I still go to church, but I used to go to this church and the pastor would say, he would give this great big sermon and then he would tell about how it should be. And then I would sit there and I would think, how do I do that? I didn't know how to take what he said and apply it to my life. So here's the how do I do that part of what we just talked about. We, Patsy and I, and when we're ministering with someone or if we're talking with someone or we're taking them through some ministry time, we'll tell them to ask God, God, show me, because he wants us to be free. He wants us to be whole more than we do. And he wants to make sure there's nothing kind of a block between us. So ask the Lord, say, Lord, show me the people that I need to forgive. So get out a piece of paper and just write, you know, jot those names down. Don't try to, you know, filter, oh, I already did that. No, that one doesn't matter. Just write down whatever name comes to your mind and include yourself, include God on the list. And then write a letter. And we expressly say, do not mail this letter. Do you hear me? Patsy, should they mail the letter?
No, do not mail the letters.
Do not mail these letters. Because we're asking you in that letter to write out every nasty, horrible, dirty, rotten, lowdown. As you can tell, I watch lots of Westerns or used to. dirty, rotten, lowdown skunk of a person that they were and what they did to you, right? Mm-hmm. Write it all out. Let's get all that pus and that ew and that goo and all the nastiness out on paper. That's why we don't want to mail them, folks. Yep. We're not causing more pain. We're getting rid of the pain in you. Mm-hmm. Write down whatever feelings you've had or you have or anything nasty or anything to do with it. Don't just say, well, I know that you didn't know any better and you hurt me. No, just write it all out. And so then you choose, after you get them all written down and you write them these letters that you do not, again, that you do not mail, then at the last line of your letter, you write on there, and I choose to forgive you and I release you from any payment. And I release myself from this situation. Mm-hmm. See, because this is about your freedom. Mm-hmm. It's not about theirs. So these are, again, not letters. You know, I kept mine for years because, and then I actually shredded mine and I wish I'd have kept them because I talk about this all the time so I can tell people about what I did. And, you know, forgiveness is such a huge thing in my life that I learned how to about warfare through my forgiveness letters and through doing forgiveness. And you know, that's a whole different topic that we'll do on another day, but forgiveness is powerful. Patsy, we can only, if we don't forgive, we don't get any healing or forgiveness. And when we do forgive, we get healing and forgiveness. So I just, you know, I cannot express how important it is to forgive.
Right. And I know that at one point you talked about keeping a journal so that you knew that you had forgiven that person. Not, you don't necessarily have to keep right. the letters and all the details, mm-hmm. but if you need to mm-hmm. write their names down and yeah. the date that you forgave them
yeah.
so you can remember. And exactly. how did that work for you, Cynthia?
Well, because I specifically had one person, I had tons of people that I needed mm-hmm. to forgive and meet myself. Mm-hmm. And it could even be you, or it could be God that's in you. You have mm-hmm. one major situation or one major person or one you or God or whomever that's a big deal in your life. And so I had so many that I couldn't just do it a blanket thing. I had to, you know, I'd think of something. And so I couldn't remember if I forgave, and it got to be really tiring because this took over months. And so I got this little notebook. To this day, I never go anywhere without a spiral binder. This is how I live my life. And I had this binder. It was in a 3-ring binder. Mine was at the time. And I would write the date when I chose to forgive. I would write the situation and the person's name, right? And the date, I made sure the date. And so I would go through, and I got quite a few pages written up. And then I found out later, and this is another topic that we'll be talking about, is I would think, you know, well, I remember, and I would catch myself, uh-oh, I chose to forgive them. Okay, I'm going to go forgive them right now. And I got looking at my notebook. Oh, I already forgave them on such and such a date. And then I'd be like, how come I'm thinking about this? And that's when you begin to realize that the enemy tries to take you places, back to places where you don't need to go. That's and so right. we'll talk about more of that in another session. But yeah, forgiveness mm-hmm. for me, I couldn't just do a blanket prayer with one person. Mm-hmm. I think that's important that people know that there are some people that you just can't say, I forgive you so-and-so
right.
because this person had, you know, years and years and years mm-hmm. of things that I needed to specifically forgive right. them for.
Right.
And for myself. And so mm-hmm. I had to go line by line by line. And mm-hmm. I think there, you know, and I don't like this statement, but I'm going to use it anyway, because it really applies. The devil's in the details, mm-hmm. but that's really true. In forgiveness, it's really in the details. Get very specific. It really mm-hmm. is.
So true.
Absolutely.
And someone else that's really important to forgive is yourself.
Yeah.
And so some of us struggle with that, like I told you with me. Mm-hmm. And so one thing that really helped me is to go to a mirror, get yourself a box of tissues because you probably will need those, and go to a mirror, either a hand mirror or a mirror in your bathroom, and look yourself in the eye and tell yourself that you forgive and say your name. I forgive you, Patsy, for. And any situation, anything that you are holding against yourself, yeah. any past sin, anything that you are holding against that's causing an impact, a negative impact in your life, that you think you're just so bad because of this, or if they knew that, if they knew this part of me, choose to forgive yourself for that yeah. and do it. Look yourself in the eye and make that choice to forgive yourself.
Exactly.
So it, and like I said, I get a box of tissues because it might be quite emotional. It's not as easy as it sounds. I found it quite difficult to keep looking myself in the eye and telling myself that. It was like, yeah. oh my gosh.
And again, Patsy, I think that's a great illustration of which we use a lot in counseling, mm-hmm. Is that we will say, for instance, myself, Cynthia, I forgive you for mm-hmm. not knowing any better. Mm-hmm. I held myself, you know, I release you from allowing this to happen to you. Mm-hmm. I forgive you for being in the wrong place at the wrong time. Mm-hmm. You know, those sorts of things, it's so important to use our voice mm-hmm. To speak it out loud yes. because it breaks the power mm-hmm. because our words have so much power. So mm-hmm. can't say it enough. When we do ministry, throughout every session, we will talk to the person and we'll say, have you forgiven them? Let's do that right now.
Exactly.
Because that is the number one reason people mm-hmm. are not whole and are not free, is because mm-hmm. of unforgiveness.
That's right. And remember that the freedom is for you, not for yeah. them.
That's right.
It's for you. And I always have to remind myself, this is not for them.
Yeah.
They don't deserve it. They don't deserve it, but it's for me. I am releasing myself. I am freeing myself. I am doing this out of obedience to God, because I want to be obedient to God, number one, and make and follow his commands. And so I'm making that choice
right.
for my sake, not for theirs.
Absolutely.
Well, is there anything else you have to add, Cynthia?
No, I think we did a pretty good job. Yeah, we are. We're getting close on time, I think.
Okay. So, well, our prayer for you is that you can break free from unforgiveness and that you can obtain everything, all that God has for you, for the healing and the freedom that he has for you, and that you can be all that he's created you to be and be and do all that he's created you to do.
That's right, Patsy. And as always, we're available if you need someone to minister to you, or if you'd like to have more information, send us an email at reallife.revised@gmail.com. Put in the subject line forgiveness so we know, and give us a little note. Let us know that you'd like some more information on maybe the notebook or how these letters, what they have contain, because we have some prompts for you if you'd like those. So as once again, send us an email at reallife.revised@gmail.com. And in the subject line, write forgiveness. So both of us, Patsy and I, want to say thank you.
Thank you so much.
We'll see you next time on Lunch and Learn. God bless you. Bye.